Greetings to one and to all. I once again want to welcome you to another study in God's Word. Now, this study we shall go through today is going to be number 12 of our study. You know, it seems like a long journey, but this is just half of what we're going through. This is like the way mark of the study. And just to keep your minds or like to keep your interest alive, there are more subjects, more interesting and more hard-hitting subjects that we're going to go through. Remember, we still have subjects like Christian living, the mark of the beast, prophecy in the end times, the judgment, the antichrist, 666, all these and many more subjects we're going to go through. Now, I will say this, these subjects alone have been, you could say, quite controversial, even for you who may be listening to this. And I'm sure that what you've been taught does not match to what you've been seeing since we've had the start of these studies. Now, some of you may be actually thinking, does it really matter knowing all these doctrines? You see, the reason we are going through these studies is because everything that we have learnt here will play a major role in the last days. If you don't know the truth, we will be deceived in the last days, even now. So as we remember from the study on the Great Controversy, Satan is at war with God. And the best way to hurt someone is obviously to not aim directly at you, but to aim at those whom you love. Just like it is with the mafia, when they know they can't get to you, they get to your family. So it is with Satan. You know, God loves us, and because of that, Satan has placed his attack directly on us. But we have a God who has overcome the world and Satan. We have one who is more powerful than Satan. One who will never leave us without help. You know, I love how Isaiah says it in Isaiah chapter 26, where it says, "Thou shalt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed upon thee, because he trusteth in thee." So, just to reaffirm, the reason on studying these subjects is not only for us to remain undeceived, but in order for us to know the truth. Now, the subject today kind of dives into my introduction. Reason being is that this subject has caused so much deception that it truly is a master plan of Satan. Before we go through the study, I just want to say that this is not an attack on anyone. It is only what we're going to see from the Bible. The subject today is entitled The State of the Dead. In this subject, we're going to ask, what happens when you die? Do you go to heaven? Do you go to hell? Well, no, we don't go to hell, as we've seen in the previous study. And also, if you have not gone through that study, I highly recommend you have. Now, today, we are going to find out exactly what happens when we die. As we mentioned before, this subject is one of Satan's master plans of deception. So let us take careful consideration on the study that we're going to go through today. Now, before we begin, if you have any questions, please just email me or you can leave it in the comments, especially as we are halfway through. I do recommend that if you have any questions regarding these subjects, please feel free to do so. Also, if there are any comments that are showing signs of foul language, mockery, etc., they will be instantly removed because I want to maintain a genuine atmosphere. And lastly, please go back and study these things for yourself, that you have a set foundation and not listening to what I have to say. And like I said in my introduction, Satan in the last days is going to cause such a deception that it will deceive even the very elect. So how do you even know that I'm deceiving you? You don't know until you go back and study for yourself. So please go back and study these things for yourself. It will also test your understanding of the Bible. As I said, we need to remain undeceived. So, not only will you go back and study these things for yourself, but you'll also be able to teach these to people that you know, and people that you care about, and people in the world you can teach to remain undeceived. So my friends, as we begin, please bow with me as we pray to open. Dear Lord, as we go through this very important subject, please I pray that you will give us the mindset to understand. Cleanse our minds from anything that may not be of you. And as we go through this subject, may we only heed to what the Bible has to say. clear our minds of any preconceived ideas, and let's look at what the Bible has to say, because that is the safeguard for all humanity. Please be with us now as we go through this study. Amen. Now let's begin with the question. What has Jesus said regarding himself? Now it says in John chapter 14 verse 6, Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. As it says here, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is, as he mentioned, the embodiment of life. Without Jesus, there will be nothing, nothing at all. It is based on him why we actually have life. Now, usually people say Jesus was a created being, but he is actually the eternal God, the creator of all things. It also says that Jesus is the truth. Now, as mentioned in my introduction, if we do not have the truth, we will be deceived in the last days, even now. Now, we're going to focus on the part where Jesus calls himself the life. Now, it says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 14, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he will show who is the blessed and the only potentate, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who only hath immortality dwelling in light, which no man can approach unto, whom no man hath seen nor can see. To him be honor and power everlasting. Amen. So, not only is Jesus life, but he is immortality, or he is immortal. You know, it's so powerful how glorious he is that no man can approach him. Now, this is talking about humanity touching divinity, not that we'll never be able to see him. You know, in a similar scenario, Moses asked God for his glory to be seen. But God replied in saying that if you see my face, you will cease to exist. So God in his mercy let Moses see his back part. So as we see Jesus, the life giver, he has told us in his word that he is not only life, but has immortal life within him. And as a life giver, he is the only one that can give you and myself life. It's quite powerful, wouldn't you agree? Now, in order for us to understand the life we have, we need to logically ask, how did we receive the life? Genesis chapter 2, verse 7 says this, and the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a what? Living soul. I guess the verse pretty much explains itself. We were formed out of the dust of the ground, we were formed not by chance or by accident, but we were formed by the very hand of God out of the dust of the ground. Now Psalm chapter 139 verse 14 says this, I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. So let us look at the foundational point. You may want to jot this down, or I'm going to show you a formula, so you may want to jot this down if you want. Body plus breath equals a living soul. So if one section is removed, it will not work. So now, by whom are our lives preserved? Acts chapter 17 verse 24 says this, God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bonds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him, and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. That's showing that God is right there waiting for us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. My friends, the context of this passage is based on a nation of people who believed that there was a God who preserved their lives, but they did not know this God. They, you could say, had a pagan traditional background, and so they believed God to be in silver, in gold, and other precious metals. This was not based on the fact that they knew he was in the precious metals or the precious things of the earth, such as the gold, the silver, etc. It was done because they did not have a chance to know who this God was. They never, ever heard of one who preserves their life. So based on their ignorance, they lived up to what was best, to what they knew. Paul has introduced them to the one who preserves life. Not only preserves life, but makes life better. And you can read that in verse 30 and 31. Now, John chapter 10, verse 10 and 11 says this: I am come that they might have life, and they might have life more abundantly. I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. So like I mentioned, Christ not only preserves our lives, but he makes our lives better. Now, as it is God who preserves our lives, how is it that we die? As we saw in the study of the Great Controversy, it was because of sin. Sin is the culprit, and so it is by our choice that once we choose to sin, we were destined to die. We choose to die. But Christ, this is the thing, Christ took that sin upon himself and died. See, in God's mercy, he allowed the human race to have life that would eventually cease, because he knows the power of sin, and it is better to remain in the grave than to live forever in sin. Imagine living in this world forever, having immortal life in the current world, the corrupt current world that we are in right now. You see, everything God does is through mercy. So now we want to ask a question that everybody wants to know, and everyone seems to have an answer for. When you die, what happens? Now, before we put the verses up, I just want to say that this is not an attack on anybody, as this subject may bring a few disappointments to certain people. But we will see from the Bible that there is no need to be disappointed, as we see that the Bible is full of hope, and this subject that we're going to go through, even though some may have ignorantly misunderstood it, there is still hope at the end. So let's continue. So what happens when we die? Genesis chapter 3 verse 19 says this: In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground, for out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. What happens when you die? Do you go anywhere? No, you go back to the ground where you came from. Now, just to state something clear, as mentioned before, some of you may have believed that when you die, you go straight to heaven, and so you may have loved ones in heaven who died. Now, before they died, they were, you know, probably helping people, they loved everyone, served people who needed serving, people who were on the street who needed help. They did all these marvelous works because Christ was in them. Now, you may have thought when they died, they are in heaven right now. But the Bible says when you die, you go back to the ground from where you came. Nothing happens to you. Now, I want to say that, as mentioned before, this is not to disappoint you. Why? Because there is a time when Christ will burst the clouds of heaven and shall shout with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. What I can say to you who may have thought this, that person who you expected to be in heaven, he is waiting in the grave on the Lord. His next conscious thought is to see the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the King of Glory, Jesus Christ. So nothing is done without hope. And as you look in the Bible, you know that Job himself, he knew exactly what happened to the condition when you die. Listen to how clear he puts it, and this is so clear that I don't even need to comment. Job chapter 14 verse 10 says this: "But man dieth and wasteth away. Yea, man giveth up the ghost, and where is he? As the waters fail from the sea, and the flood decayeth and drieth up, so man lieth down and riseth not till the heavens be no more. They shall not awake, nor be raised out of their sleep. Oh that thou wouldest hide me in the grave, that thou wouldest keep me secret until thy wrath be past, that thou wouldest appoint me a set time and remember me. If a man die, shall he live again? All the days of my appointed time will I wait till my change come." That is so clear. Job acknowledges death as a sleep. Now this sleep is until the heavens are no longer here. He is talking about when God returns, the world and heavens as we know it to be no more. And we see, or as we've seen in the previous study on the millennium, the case is just as it is. When a man is dead or sleeping, he does not rise up again. We're talking about a man in his entire state here. Not just a physical being, but everything that makes a person a living person. As we saw in the equation, body plus breath equals a living soul. So those who have died are no more. They have gone back to the grave, and the breath has gone back to God. It has left their bodies and has returned to Christ, the life giver, the source of life. Now Job clearly shows that when a man dies, he dies until his change come. But what change is this? As again we've seen in the study of heaven, it is the change of our corruptible bodies to our incorruptible bodies. It is when we change from mortal to immortality. Now today there is a belief that when you die, you go straight to heaven, or if you die, you go straight to hell. Now, once again, we've covered this topic, but I just want to clear some bits on this. Now, I'm going to point out two scenarios. Let's use the example of a man who died and was raised to life. Some of you may know of him. His name is Lazarus. Lazarus was dead for about 4 days, so his body started to decay. They requested Jesus to heal him, but Jesus had not come straight away as he would have. He knew that there was a purpose for everything. Everything was for the glory of God. And so he came and rose Lazarus up 4 days later. Now if you notice the things Jesus did, it was not just for the sake of a miracle, but there was an object lesson. There was always an object lesson in what Jesus did. Now listen to the object in this lesson concerning death, because you can even see the doctrine of death in just this miracle of Lazarus. Right, if when you die, you go to heaven, what do you think the first words of Lazarus will be after being raised? Bearing in mind that when you die, you go to heaven, as is popularly taught. I would think that he would be very upset. Think about it. Lazarus walking on the streets of gold, talking with his guardian angel, enjoying all the pleasures of heaven, traveling to other planets, talking with God the Father. And then he feels a hard touch on his shoulder, turns around to see his guardian angel say, Lazarus, you're not going to like this, but Jesus is about to resurrect you, so you have to leave now. The next minute he wakes up and is back on earth. Jesus rose that man for a reason, and especially for the reason of those 4 days, to show us an object lesson that when you die, you know nothing, just as Job said. Now the other example. Now when a person dies, we typically see their bodies right in front of us, right? But when one has risen from the dead, are their bodies still there? No. Or rather, are their bodies still dead while the person is apparently alive? When Jesus rose from the dead, what happened to his body? What do we see left behind? All we see is the clothes that covered him. At funerals, the speaker may say, "Our dearly beloved friend is now in heaven, enjoying the pleasure of peace, but yet their body is still in the coffin. Now, I'm not here knocking the sincerity of people, but we are just looking into what the Bible has to say. Now, the Bible says, when you die, you stay in the grave until the resurrection. So those who you may have thought are actually in heaven right now, the truth of the matter, according to the Bible, is that they're in the graves. But not only in the graves, but the hope is that they are in the graves until Jesus comes and raises them up again. Now, I understand there are verses you may want to show. So if you have any questions or any requests, please don't hesitate to put them, as I believe that we ought to answer everything from the Bible. But I also wanted to share another verse in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 35. It says, but some man will say, how are the dead raised up, and with what body do they come up? So again, when you are risen from the dead, your body also is risen too. As we saw with the formula, body plus breath equals a living soul. Now, I believe this passage of scripture pretty much explains the outcome of the whole form of man at the state of death. Now, Job describes it once again as a sleep. When you die, you waste away until the resurrection, as Job said. Job said, till my change come. That change is when we are all glorified, when we hear the sweet voice of Christ coming with a great shout. I like how my friend mentioned it. He said that God's voice is going to be so loud that it even wakes the dead. So, as we see in the verse, the previous one in regards to Job chapter 14, we see the following. Number one, when one dies, they waste away. Number two, when one dies, your breath leaves your body, which indicates you are completely dead. Number three, when one dies, they remain in the grave. Four, when one dies, they remain dead until the appointed time. And number five, when one dies, they will not live again until the change at the second resurrection. So when one dies, we remain dead. Nothing happens. You know, one time I heard a minister give the subject I'm talking about now. He told me a story about a woman's son who went to war and was told that her son had died in action. She was, as any loving mother would be, upset. On one evening, she noticed a person in her room who looked very familiar. She noticed that it was her son. She went to hug and kiss him in such joy. She spoke to him and he gave her soothing words, saying, I'm okay, everything is okay. Now, there were a series of seminars happening. The topic was about the state of the dead. When she heard the message, she went to speak to the pastor, and the pastor explained that when the dead die, they remain dead until the resurrection. And he also showed her some other verses, which I'm showing today. She remembered that her son was reported as dead in action, dead in war. And so you can imagine the shock, because if her son was dead, who was in the room? The next day, her son was in the room and she remembered what the pastor spoke of. She said, in the name of Jesus, get out. You are not my son. The Bible says that the dead remain dead. Get out in the name of Jesus. As soon as the spirit heard her words, he looked at her with a deceitful smile and disappeared right in front of her eyes. The person she saw was not her son, because her son was dead. Indeed, she saw a demonic spirit imitating her son. My friend, I don't know if you have encountered this experience for yourself, and it may have seemed so real, but we are studying the Bible in order for us to remain undeceived, because I believe Satan will use this subject to deceive people in the last days. And if you'd like to know more on that bit, on why I believe he will, please ask me and I will show it in another video. Now, When we die, what happens to our spirit? Again, if we look at Genesis chapter 3, verse 19, in the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread till thou return unto the ground, for out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. So once again, here we have a clear indication on the state of man's death. When we die, our spirits go back to God. We go back to the dirt or the dust where we originally came from, and life is absent. To put it in simpler terms, let's use an example. A mobile phone cannot survive without a battery, right? A battery and a mobile phone come together and we have a live mobile phone. Now we can say the mobile phone itself is our bodies. The spirit is like, or the breath is the battery. Can either the mobile or the battery function on its own? No. This question and verse alone shows that the truth on the state of the dead is that when man dies, he remains. If he has no breath, he cannot live. If breath is on its own, it cannot survive without a body. So when we die, it is logical that our breath goes back to the one who breathed in life in the first place. We don't have dead spirits floating around in the atmosphere. Everyone who has died remains, as I mentioned, dead. Or in other words, returned to the earth which they came. So when we die, our spirits go back to God. Now in modern day, spirit is likened to a spirit without a body, a person in invisible form, or someone who can be seen by the spirit, but we in our natural eyes can't see the spirit itself. But again, we must be careful, because we have seen so far how clear it is that when one dies, they remain dead. The word spirit can also mean breath, which is what we have been seeing throughout the course of this question. As we continue this study of the Bible, we will see further evidence of the nature of man. Like, for example, in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7 says this: "Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it." And once again, a very clear answer. Now, as we saw in Genesis, when we die, we go back to the dust which we came. That's why when one dies, they turn into dust. Have you noticed that? When one dies, they rot away and all you see is dust. As mentioned also, the spirit we once had when we were alive goes back to God. When Christ comes again, it is so logical that he gives it back to us. Okay, so what do the dead actually know? Ecclesiastes chapter 9 verse 4 says this: "For to him that is joined to all the living there is hope, for a living dog is better than a dead lion. For the living know that they shall die," but this is the punchline, "but the dead know not anything, neither have they any more a reward, for the memory of them is forgotten. Also their love and their hatred and their envy is now perished, neither have they any more a portion forever in anything that is done under the sun." The dead, as we ask the question, knows nothing. It is only the living who knows that they will die, whilst the dead know nothing. There was a time where I did research on a certain movie, and the actors that did the movies too. I saw a video clip of Denzel, you heard of him, Denzel Washington, talking about his experience and how he was able to perform such a good performance in that movie. Listen to what he says. Now I'm going to play a quick clip for you to listen to as he says.
So many of Hollywood's most famous actors and actresses able to be so amazingly effective and convincing in their performances?
That guy was so electrifying that it came through the television.
How is it that they can move us to laughter, tears, or anger at the drop of a hat? Are they truly gifted with natural talent, as many suggest?
You see this and you're dazzled by their talent.
Do they possess a creative streak of genius that is unknown to most men? Or unknown to most men, are they in fact possessed? Is it possible that these actors and actresses are possessed by demonic spirits who have a specific agenda to fulfill? Oscar award-winning actor Denzel Washington told 60 Minutes exactly how he brings forth his best performances.
Basically what I did was got on my knees and sort of communicated with the spirits. And when I came out, I was in charge.
Powerful scene.
Powerful scene. I couldn't have acted that. I couldn't have written that down and made a decision to play that.
What, are you gonna smoke that?
Nope, you are.
Hell if I am.
Yeah, Jesus freak. Yeah, Jesus.
Now, I'm not doubting Denzel's sincerity, but the point is, my friend, that from the Bible we know that the dead knows nothing. So who was he actually speaking to? I hope this study so far has been pretty clear from the Bible, because it's always best to get a set foundation, because you can understand things better for yourself. The living know that there is a time when they will cease to live if Christ does not come again, or rather if Christ doesn't come first before. But the dead know not anything. They cannot communicate with the living, which I mentioned before. They are dead. Again, Psalm chapter 146 verse 4 says this: His breath goeth forth, he returneth to his earth, in that very day his thoughts perish. My friends, I just hope these verses have been quite clear, because we are now going to ask a question which mostly every religion in the world believes. Question: when you die, do you go straight to heaven? Psalm chapter 115 verse 17 says this: The dead praise not the Lord, neither any that go down into silence. Psalm chapter 6 verse 5 says this: For in death there is no remembrance of thee. In the grave, who shall give thee thanks? My friend, there are many teachings, popular teachings, that say that when you die, you go to heaven. Friends, does the Bible teach that? From what we have seen, the answer is no. Now, I know this is another touchy subject, so if you have any questions, please, I'm actually recommending that you ask questions, because they will be answered from the Bible. Psalms 104 verse 29 says this: Thou hidest thy face, they are in trouble. Thou takest away their breath, they die and return to their earth. Now here comes the hope, as we mentioned regarding those things which we studied, and also regarding those people who have died in hope. What takes place at the second coming of Jesus? But I would not have you be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep or who are dead, that ye sorrow not, which means do not be upset, do not be down, even as others which have no hope. So reason in verse 13 is basically saying, don't be ignorant about, what I'm going to show you. Be joyful, because there's some people who do not know this and they don't have hope, but you have hope. Verse 14 says, For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Verse 18 is the comfort. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. I bring you comfort and hope for those whom you have loved and who have died in the Lord, that when Christ comes again, he will bring them up, as the verse says. Amen. The breath the living had before they died will be given back to them. They will again receive the breath of life. The Lord is going to bring life back again to how it was to be. Isn't that exciting to know that your friends and your family who have been faithful will be brought back to life? So as it says in verse 18, and so I emphasize, I comfort one and all with these words. Be ye happy because death has been accomplished, death has been conquered by Christ. Once you believe in Christ, you receive everlasting life. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. So if Christ takes away your sin, what does he give you in exchange? He gives you eternal life. So be joyful, my friends, in knowing that when a person dies in the Lord, it is only a temporal thing, as why the Bible calls it a sleep. There is still more to come for that person. All we have to do is trust in what Christ has said. So to that, my friends, I say a big amen. My dad died in the Lord, and I was not too sad about it because I have comfort that I will see him again. My mother is not too well at the moment either. I'm not too worried about it because I know I will see her on resurrection morning. Be comforted, my friends. Be comforted. John chapter 5 verse 28 says this: Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice, and shall come forth, and they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. When Christ comes, everyone will hear him. Those who rise to life at the second coming, and those who rise to damnation after the 1,000 years. If you have not listened to the study, please listen to it because it will make sense. It's called the millennium. We do not want to be partakers of the resurrection of the damnation because Christ already took away your sins. He has made the path clear for you to walk. It is up to you if you want to walk the path of life. Why not choose the path, the correct path? Don't you want to live in life rather than death? Rather accept the free gift, because the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life? Do you not want to receive eternal life? I'll leave that for you to consider. Now, what will happen at the second coming of Christ? We've asked this question, but we need to ask it again. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51 says this: Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is in the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, as we come to a close, I did some research on the film called Avatar. This film was top rated probably throughout the whole world. But I'm not here to talk about the movie per se, but the result it left in people's minds. This movie had such a geographical, heavenly look that it made this world look so depressing. I read in the papers that people experienced so much depression that attempts to commit suicide was acted in behalf of believing they can go to Avatar. There is no Avatar. It doesn't exist. My friend, if Christ did not rise from his death, we will never have hope. As it says in 1 Corinthians, if we have Christ in this life only, we will be miserable. Because Christ rose from the grave, he made a clear example that death can never, ever hold anyone, because Christ defeated death. Because of death and resurrection of Christ, we will be perfected. Mortal to immortality. Corruption to incorruption. Imperfection to perfection. It will finally be over, my friends. Are you excited about that? I most certainly am, and I pray that this study has caused you to think and hope, and may have brought about clarity, as there may be many out there who may believe that when you die, you go to heaven. This, to some, is a life-changing subject, and this is my appeal to you and to all. We have seen that the dead do not know anything. That the dead die and remain until the resurrection, and that no man is able to communicate with the dead. Satan will use this deception, this doctrine, in the last days to deceive the people in living in darkness. But with the truth, there is always light that removes the darkness. So my friends, if it is your choice to say, Lord, I see the truth in your word. I know that the dead remain dead until the resurrection. If I should die, I want a guaranteed spot that my life is secure in you by accepting you as my Lord and my Savior. I want to be saved and want to have hope knowing that my loved ones are saved. And so, again, if you want to say, Lord, please give me the comfort that only comes from you. And please prepare me to stand in the last days. Thank you for this message on the state of the dead, as it was clear. And so, if it is your will to spread the truth as it is in Jesus, please bow with me as we pray to close. Dear Lord, we thank you for this subject, and we thank you for the clarity in your word. I pray that for the person who has just watched this video, that this person will go back and study these things for themselves, that they may have a set foundation on who they are believing in. Be with us, Lord. Be with our minds, be with our hearts, and may we follow after righteousness. These things we pray in Jesus' name, in thanking you for this study. Prepare us for the next one. Amen.